Addiction. It takes many forms and wears many faces, like a demon walking among us. It takes over your life, crawling in and changing you from the inside out. Breaking an addiction is hard, but oftentimes not giving it up is much harder. That was a difficult lesson to learn for three people: Joey Walker, Dolly McGregor, and Paul Abels. These three had never met one another, and now they never will. But each one of them had two things in common. First was that each had an addiction they felt like they couldn't shake. And second was that they each had a run-in with SCP-666. Joey Walker was at the end of his rope when he encountered it. Everyone has bad days, but for Joey, every day for the last 15 years has been a bad day. He was pushing 40 with nothing to show for it, except credit card debt, a scraggly beard, and a beat-up old Mustang. But booze had always been there for him. No matter how bad things got, he could always count on a glass full of comfort at the end of the day. But to paraphrase a quote by Stephen King, sometimes when a man takes a drink, the drink takes the man. And Joey Walker had been long since taken. He was a transient worker, doing jobs wherever jobs needed doing, but he never expected that he would end up all the way to Tibet working construction. Not that he was complaining. Sure, it was cold, but there was plenty of Tibetan Chang to enjoy. It was a drink so good that legends even say that Yetis would raid villages in the mountains just to get a little taste. Joey had taken a liking to the Chang, and it was what he had been drinking when he crashed his car up in the mountains, leaving him stranded in the snow. Joey had survived the crash itself, but he knew he wouldn't last long in the cold. He needed shelter. That's why he felt like he could hardly believe his luck when he first saw the yurt, a kind of traditional Tibetan tent made from animal skins. Joey had never seen anything quite like it, but any refuge from the storm would do. He pushed forward through the snow and climbed inside. But the inside of the yurt was nothing like the outside. In fact, it seemed like an exact replica of his favorite sports bar back in Atlantic City. It was warm. There was all the old memorabilia on the walls, and every screen was showing the Saints wiping the floor with the Colts in the 2010 Super Bowl. Joey didn't even question it. He just smiled and approached the bar. He even recognized the bartender, Malcolm, a good old friend of his. Malcolm smiled back at him, but there was something oddly menacing in his grin.
"Welcome back," he said. "I thought you'd hauled your sorry keister off to Tibet. Guess you gave up on that too, just like everything else."
"Well, except..." Malcolm pushed a glass of beer towards him across the bar and glared. Joey didn't understand why Malcolm was being so aggressive, but he didn't question that either. He grabbed the glass and drank it up, guzzling it down before slamming the empty glass down on the bar. Malcolm kept the drinks coming, round after round, and Joey kept knocking them back. He didn't notice when the TV screens turned to static. He didn't notice when the other patrons at the bar began to jitter and twitch, turning little by little into something less than human. He didn't even notice when Malcolm's face started melting off his skull as long as he kept pouring. Before he could even really understand what was happening to him, Joey Walker was dead. His liver and kidneys had given out on him. His corpse would later be found frozen on the Tibetan mountainside, just 30 feet away from his crash car. The coroner's report would list his cause of death as accidental, but this was no accident. He'd fallen victim to SCP-666, an anomalous yurt known to some as the Spirit House. The being he'd call Malcolm is known to the Foundation as SCP-666-1, and Joey had failed its challenge. Sadly for our inebriated friend, the penalty for failure is death. Next on our list of human tragedies comes Dolly McGregor, a 62-year-old woman from Anaheim, California. Dolly was never averse to the drink, but she knew how to enjoy her mojitos in moderation. You rarely get to 62 if you don't. And Dolly could tell people with pride that she had 2 children and 6 grandchildren, whom she didn't see nearly often enough for her liking. She also had over $100,000 in gambling debt owed to a number of casinos on the Vegas Strip. Ever since her husband Albert had passed away several years prior,
Shooting craps, playing blackjack, and whiling away the hours in front of the slot machines had been a welcome change from loneliness. But in Vegas, fortunes can change in an instant. Dolly had gone from being on a hot winning streak to losing everything. The casinos extended her lines of credit until she was gambling with money she'd never be able to pay back. But that didn't stop her. She'd been selling off everything, even remortgaging the house that Albert had built with his own two hands to try and keep up with her ballooning debts. Still, it wasn't enough, but she couldn't stop either. It wasn't even that she felt good about it anymore. It was just that she only ever felt normal among the flashing lights of slot machines and the clatter of dice. She needed to get away, as far away as possible. She heard about people reaching spiritual enlightenment in Tibet. They'd discover God, or gods, or sometimes just a sense of inner peace. Whatever it was, she needed to find it and get this demon off her back. So she took the last of her savings and flew off to Tibet to clear her head. She didn't know if there were any casinos in Lhasa, but if there were, her money would surely be no good there. It was exactly what she needed. But Tibet wasn't the promised land she thought it would be. Wherever Dolly went, there she was, with the same vices and demons chasing her. The first night she spent in Lhasa, she used the hotel Wi-Fi to download an online poker app on her phone. This culminated in another couple $1,000 lost, and a panic attack that caused Dolly to throw her phone into her toilet before wandering off into the wilderness. She just needed to get away. But time and space got away from her, and eventually she was knee-deep in snow. Where had she come from? Where could she go? It quickly dawned on her that if she didn't find some kind of shelter soon, she'd be done for. But all she could do was keep walking. That's when she happened upon SCP-666. The yurt was like an oasis on the barren mountainside. She didn't expect comfort inside, but it could at least provide her some shelter until the staff back at the hotel noticed she was gone. Then they'd come and save her, right? Right. But when she passed through the yak leather flap into the yurt, Dolly wasn't in an ancient tent in the Tibetan wilderness. She was on a casino floor. There was a big, beautiful roulette table before her, attended to by a grinning, well-dressed croupier. They were flanked by an army of slot machines, and all the pleasing, familiar sounds of cheerful gambling rang out through the air. She approached the table, and the croupier shook his head in what seemed like disappointment. "Ah, back again, eh, Dolly?" he said with a sigh. "Of course, I should have expected it. After all, what else do you have in that empty little life of yours, hmm? Without all this, you'd be nothing, right? Nothing at all. Since Albert died and the kids want nothing to do with you, we're all you've got. So, Dolly, what'll it be? Red or black? Are you feeling lucky?" His words wounded Dolly, but that wouldn't stop her. She grabbed her chips and put them all on red. One last spin couldn't hurt. What did she have to lose? She blinked, and she wasn't sitting at the table anymore. She was upright, but she wasn't standing. Her wrists and ankles were bound to something, to a wheel, a giant roulette wheel, like it was some kind of medieval torture device. The croupier was standing across from her, well, something that used to be a croupier. His face was flickering in and out. Sometimes it was human, sometimes it was a mass of eyes and teeth. More demons were sitting all at the slot machines behind him, pulling levers made from human bones. "Good choice, Dolly," the croupier said. "Red suits you." He reached out and gave the wheel a spin. Dolly was lost in an overwhelming, pulsing cascade of lights, colors, and sounds. The horrific, tinny noises of slot machines and the laughter of the demonic croupier. She was lost in panic and terror as she just kept spinning and spinning and spinning. When her body was eventually found, her muscles were in the advanced stages of atrophy, as though she hadn't been moving for years. Her brain was rotted, and the cause of death was determined as sudden cardiac arrest after an extended period of sleep deprivation and malnutrition. Dolly's family would never really know what happened to her. The SCP Foundation has learned a lot about SCP-666 after containing it in Site-73. Its anomalous effects, namely vivid, complex, and potentially fatal hallucinatory experiences, only affect those with some kind of addiction or dependency. To anyone else entering the yurt, it's just a normal tent. but any addicts who enter will fall under its spell and are generally transported back to the place where their addiction was at its strongest. There they'll encounter SCP-666-1, an entity that takes the form of a figure from the subject's life, normally one heavily involved in facilitating their addiction. Any kind of addiction seems to trigger it. Alcohol, drugs, gambling, pornography, food, self-destructive behavior, even video games. SCP-666 kills its victims with a twisted mockery of the very thing that they were dependent on in life. It was only with Paul Abels that the Foundation started discovering the other side of the coin. By almost all accounts, Paul is a worse person than anyone on this list. He got addicted to hard drugs early on in life, and took up a life of violent crime to support his habit. He murdered two people during a liquor store robbery before being convicted and sentenced to death. He'd then been picked up as a D-class by the SCP Foundation, and selected as a test subject for SCP-666 due to his history of drug abuse. The Foundation expected to be adding his body to the incineration pile sometime soon. None of the researchers working on the case predicted what actually ended up happening. Paul was forced to enter the yurt. Not long after, he found himself standing in a place he'd done everything to try to forget. The dark graffiti-stained alley where he'd been sold his first hit. This was the place that destroyed his life. Every bad decision he'd ever made could be traced back to here, and specifically to one man, Frank. Frank was his first dealer, and now here he was, standing right across from him once more. Frank was grinning like a demon.
"Come on, Polly," he said. "You gotta trash. We both know what you're gonna do. Don't you feel it? The itch? Come on, one more hit, Polly. That's all you need to feel better. It's time to take your medicine."
Frank, or this thing pretending to be Frank, was right. He did feel the itch. He did want it. Maybe he was no better than this. He began to reach out towards Frank, but then he abruptly pulled his hand back. Frank's eyes widened in genuine surprise as Paul replied, "I'm sorry, that's not me anymore." SCP-666-1 gave a smile and said,
"Maybe it isn't, Polly. Maybe it isn't."
When Paul Abels was removed from the SCP-666 yurt by one of the attending guards, the Foundation researchers discovered something amazing. Paul was very much alive, and more incredibly, he didn't feel the cravings anymore. His addiction was gone. And further tests showed that Paul wasn't a one-off event. In fact, anyone who denies the temptation of SCP-666 will see their addictions miraculously disappear when they finally leave. After this, it became clear to the Foundation that SCP-666 isn't just a way to punish addicts. It's a kind of test. Those who want to change, who are willing to truly confront their demons and resist the pull of temptation, are rewarded with the one thing they want most in their life: freedom from their addiction. SCP-666 can be your doom or your salvation. And like most things in life, you get what you give. Now check out SCP-610, The Flesh That Hates, and SCP-1730, What Happened to Site-13, for more anomalous places straight out of your worst nightmares.